Welcome to our service of worship and celebration on the second Sunday of Lent here at the Little Home Church by the Wayside in Wayne, Illinois. Today, our service is going to focus specifically for February 28th on our celebration in the United States and actually around the world of Black History Month. Thanks to all who donated either bras or financial help to our Mardi Gras service. We collected 134 bras, as well as cash donations, which will help in the shipment of those bras to get to the countries that they need to get to. So thank you again, Little Home Church, a job well done. Join us for Walk and Talk every Sunday morning at 9, Bible study every Wednesday morning at 10. Sisters in Spirit, SIS, is holding their annual spring flower sale. Order forms are on our website, or they can be picked up at the church office. The orders are due by March 8th. Happy birthday wishes this week to Glenn, Mary Emily, and Gianna. Our Lenten series will be released on Monday, March 1st. Again, this will be an approximate 30-minute video, just like our church service. You'll receive an email about it. That will be a lecture on music, art, and the church in various style periods. This Monday, we begin with the style periods of the Middle Ages and the Renaissance. The flowers today are provided by the Rick and Nancy Alex in celebration of Brenda's birthday. For joys and concerns, we want to remember Peg, who is about to undergo some testing. Carissa, who is recovering from knee surgery. Prayers for Anne's cousins, Robin and Susie, along with a friend, Jeff. Prayers for Lori's nephew, who is deploying to Kuwait. Continued prayers for Jason Worrell, recovering from a gunshot wound. For Janice and her family. For Michael, a former student of mine. And Linda, Carol's sister in California. Please send photos to the church office of things going on in your life and your family's lives, and help us stay connected. And for all other information, please visit the church website, or the screen has information at the end of the service. Thank you.
Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship. I dream a world where man no other man will scorn, where love will bless the earth and peace its paths adorn. I dream a world where all will know sweet freedom's way, where greed no longer saps the soul, nor avarice blights our day. A world I dream where black or white, whatever race you be, will share the bounties of the earth, and every man is free, where wretchedness will hang its head, and joy, like a pearl, attends the needs of all mankind. Of such I dream, my world.
Yeah.
Please join me in the prayer of invocation. Open unto me light for my darkness. Open unto me courage for my fear. Open unto me hope for my despair. Open unto me peace for my turmoil. Open unto me joy for my sorrow. Open unto me strength for my weakness. Open unto me wisdom for my confusion. Open unto me forgiveness for my sins. Open unto me tenderness for my thoughts. Open unto me love for my hates. Open unto me thyself for myself. Lord, Lord, open unto me. Please join me in the prayer of confession. Spirit of the living God, we have gathered in this place this morning. Allow your spirit to fill our very being. Most gracious and loving God, we remember the struggles of our people, Black people, people of African descent, your people, and thank you for your grace, your love, and your mercy. We thank you for leaders that you continue to place in high places and ordinary places. Inspire each of us to work more faithfully for justice and dignity of life everywhere. Lord God, we remember the hurts of exclusion and prejudice, but we know that you can raise our vision above all barriers and give us wisdom and courage to make this a better world. As you give us yourself in the bread of hope and the cup of mercy, show us how to give ourselves to those who are without hope and to those who cry for mercy. Lord God, rule over our spirit in this hour that we will go from this worship with the freedom of those who trust in you. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Here is the assurance of pardon. You can look behind. You can search ahead. God will meet you in between. God promises to always be right there. If you believe this to be so, if you believe God is between here and there, between me and you, share that peace with your neighbor. Amen. Hi, kids. Today I want to talk to you about being first and what that means. And I was thinking as I was getting ready to talk to you that you could think of what it means to be first in your mind. Maybe you were the first person to get up this morning in your family. What are some other ways you could be first? Maybe you were the first person to get your coat on when it was time to go outside if you go to school for recess. Or even if you don't go to school and you're still studying at home, maybe you were the first person to finish a test. Or maybe you were the first person to remember your friend's birthday. These are lots of ways that you could be first. And another way you could be first is to be the first person to do something that no one has ever done before who's like you. And since it's February and it's Black History Month, I wanted to talk about some African Americans who were first. They were the first Black people to do something in our country. And I have a collection of four people who were firsts. And you might recognize one or some of them. So the first person I want to tell you about is this lady right here. And she won a big tennis match. What was that tennis match? Do you know her name? She's a Black woman. She's a really, really good tennis player. Any guesses? No, not Serena Williams. Althea Gibson. She was the first Black tennis champion at Wimbledon, which is a big tennis tournament in England. And that was in 1957. So that was a big first. The second big first is this Black woman. And her name is Ruby Bridges. And in 1960, she became the youngest Black child to go to an all-white school in the southern part of the United States. Now, this black person led a country. This black person was the first African American to be president of the United States. I bet you might know this person, President Obama. That's right. And the last person in my group was the first person to lead the Library of Congress. And her name is Carla Hayden. And she became the first black Librarian of Congress in 2016. She heads the world's biggest library. So all of these people were firsts, famous firsts. But only one of these people was a first as a little kid. The other three people all were grown-ups or young adults when they became a first. So Ruby Bridges became a first when she was only 6 years old. And so I thought it would be nice to talk about her today and tell you guys, you may have heard of Ruby Bridges before. And I went to the library to get this book about her, and this is written by Ruby Bridges. And it's at a second grade reading level, but it gives you the basic information about her story. Ruby Bridges goes to school. A long time ago, some people thought that black people and white people should not be friends. In some places, black people were not allowed to live in the same neighborhoods as white people. In some places, black people were not allowed to eat in the same restaurants as white people. See, there's a sign that says white only. So if you were a black person, you could not go into that restaurant. And in some places, black children and white children could not go to the same schools. This is called segregation. The United States government said, segregation is wrong. People should live where they want to live. People should eat where they want. Children should go to school where they want. And a lot of times that meant going to school right down the street to your neighborhood school. My name is Ruby Bridges. In 1960, I went to kindergarten in a school for black children. I liked my school. I liked my teacher. I liked my friends. Here she is. But there was a school for white children even closer to my house than the school for black children. It was the William France Elementary School. The government said Ruby Bridges should be allowed to go to the William France School. It was only a couple of blocks away from her house. In 1961, I was in first grade. My mother took me to the France School. Marshals came with us to make sure that we were safe. And the marshals were kind of like guards for Ruby because some people were very upset that she should go to the white school. Look, she's only a little tiny kid. Some people did not want a black child to go to the white school. They stood near the school. They yelled at me to go away. You can see some of their signs here. Now, Ruby said later that she thought it was, she couldn't hear what they were saying, and she thought it was part of a parade. Parents took their children out of the school. I was alone with my teacher, Mrs. Henry. And the other thing Ruby mentioned, told about later, was that the first day in the school, she only sat in the principal's office because all of the white parents were taking the kids out of school and they couldn't get school going that day So at the end of the first day, Ruby said, well, that was an easy school to go to. Just sit in the principal's office all day. So this was after the first day. She was all alone with her teacher because there were no white students in the class. I loved Mrs. Henry, and Mrs. Henry loved me. I was a very good student. I learned math. I learned how to read. But I wished the children would come back. So for many weeks, the white children stayed away from the school. Their parents didn't bring them. Months and months passed. Then one day, children began to come back to school. At last, I had friends to play with. I was very, very happy. Here she is. Many people have read about me in newspapers and books. A famous writer, John Steinbeck, wrote about me. He wrote that I was very brave. A first lady, Eleanor Roosevelt, wrote a letter to me. The letter told me that I was a good American. Norman Rockwell was an artist who painted a picture of me. The painting has become very famous. See something here. I'll show you a color picture of this painting in a little bit. Now I am grown up. I am married. I have children. One day, Mrs. Henry and I were both asked to be on a TV show. That was the first time we had seen each other in many years. Now we talk to each other often. Now black children and white children can go to the same schools. I like to visit schools. I tell my story to children. I tell children that black people and white people can be friends. And most important, I tell children to be kind to each other. So that is the Ruby Bridges story. So I told you I would share that one painting I showed, some colored pictures, and that was painted by a man whose name is Norman Rockwell. And he initially started painting stories about different people, and then later in his life he painted pictures about things that were going on in America. So here is the picture that I showed you in the black and white book. And look, what can you see right here? Can you see that? It's a smashed tomato. And among other things that were happening that day, people were throwing things at the school and at Ruby as she tried to go to school. And here she is, a little girl with these tall men protecting her, and people were throwing tomatoes and yelling things and making a scene about a black child going to school with white kids. So that's the Ruby Bridges, that's her story, and I had just a couple more pictures to show you of Ruby in real life. So here's another picture of Ruby going into her elementary school. And you can see the marshals who are protecting her. You see how small she is. She's only a first grader. But she is very brave. And here she is coming out of school at the end of one of the days. Again, she's only 6 years old, all by herself, all day with her teacher. Very brave. And here she is with another first, President Obama, talking about the painting. And the painting that I showed you that Norman Rockwell had painted, President Obama had that brought to the White House while he was president. So here they were talking about it, and it was one of the first times she'd actually gotten to see the painting in real life. So I hope you learned a little bit today about being the first to do something and how it can be, you can be brave and you can be scared, but you can still do it, and sometime in your life, you might be the first to do something. And now let's put our hands together and say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This is the time in our worship service where we actively and intentionally take part in the support of the ministry of Christ. If you are a member of Little Home Church, we encourage you to continue your pledges and financial support. And if you are visiting with us today, we welcome your gifts as well. You may donate by Venmo, PayPal, or by sending a check into the church office through the mail. The information is on the screen. Without talking back, without asking questions, let us move into God's love. Let us go with God to offer our gifts. Let us give God our thanks in our tithes and offerings. Bless these gifts with your love, O God, so that we might share them quite openly with all who need your change. Amen. From the Old Testament today is Genesis chapter 17, verses 1 through 7, and verses 15 through 16. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, I am God Almighty, walk before me and be blameless, and I will make my covenant between me and you, and will make you exceedingly numerous. Then Abram fell on his face, and God said to him, As for me, this is my covenant with you. You shall be the ancestor of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be Abram, but your name shall be Abraham, for I have made you the ancestor of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations of you, and kings shall come from you. I will establish my covenant between me and you and your offspring, after you throughout their generations, for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and to your offspring after you. God said to Abraham, As for Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall give rise to nations. Kings of peoples shall come from her. The New Testament reading is from Romans chapter 4, verses 13 through 25. For the promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null, and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham. For he is the father of all of us, as it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. In the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead, and calls into existence the things that do not exist. Hoping against hope, he believed that he would become the father of many nations, according to what was said, "So numerous shall your descendants be." He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was already as good as dead, for he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No distrust made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Therefore, his faith was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now the words, "it was reckoned to him," were written not for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be reckoned to us who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was handed over to death for our trespasses and was raised for our justification. This is the word of the Lord.
The story that Anne read today about Abraham and Sarah is probably one of the most recognized stories in the Old Testament. I remember growing up and people getting all caught up in the fact that this couple, who were around 100 years old, were going to have a baby. And it's a pretty good story plot to get your attention, but there's far more to that story. God changes Abram's name to Abraham, the father of many nations. And it says in Romans, Abraham is the father of us all. I love how the story is revisited in Paul's letter to the Romans in the New Testament. All of this happened to Abraham because of his faith, not the law. And then in the version Anne read today, Paul says, hoping against hope, Abraham believed. And as Abraham gave glory to God, his faith became stronger. I grew up hearing a phrase, when you can't pray your way through, praise your way through. February is called Black History Month. Today, I want to read you some stories of some Black Americans who I'd never heard of, but I learned about through research. These folks would call Abraham their father too, and they did some very amazing things by hoping against hope and answering the call of God. Pierre Toussaint was born into a Catholic slave family on June 27, 1766, on a French plantation in Haiti. The Bouchard family educated him as a house slave and took him with them when they moved to New York City in 1787. He was apprenticed as a hairdresser, and since the wealthy had hairdressers come to their homes, and he was allowed to keep much of his earnings. His kind and cheerful disposition assured a steady and lucrative position in the society of the time. He took the surname Toussaint in honor of the hero of the Haitian Revolution. Due to his service to the family, he was freed at age 45. He then married and purchased a house where together he and his wife fostered orphans, supporting them in getting an education and learning a trade. Bilingual in French and English, he was able to help many Haitian immigrants, organizing a credit bureau, an employment agency, and a refuge for destitute travelers. He attended daily masses and was a benefactor of many charitable organizations. He died on June 30th, 1853, and was declared venerable in the Catholic Church in 1996. O God, through your servant Pierre, you show us the many ways of bringing social justice into society. Move us to actions of solidarity with the poor, the humble, and the lowly. Mary Elizabeth Lang was born around 1789 in Santiago de Cuba, where she lived in a primarily French-speaking community. She came to Baltimore, where a great number of Catholic French-speaking refugees had settled. Although Elizabeth was a refugee, she was well-educated and wealthy due to money left to her by her father. In 1828, with the help of Father James Joubert, she and two other Black women started a school for Black Catholic children. The following year, she and three other Haitian women pronounced vows in what became known as the Oblate Sisters of Providence, the first religious order of women of African descent. At first, their educational work met with success, and the sisters won praise for nursing victims of the cholera epidemic. But internal difficulties led to a split. Mother Lang eventually resumed leadership in 1844, and despite discouragement, racism, and a lack of funds, the sisters continued to educate children and minister to the needs of the Black Catholic community. She died on February 3rd, 1882, but the Oblate sisters continue on. O God, your servant Mother Mary Lang brought the light of learning to a generation struggling to find a place in society. Help us to be providence as we find ways to contribute to the betterment of others' lives. Thea Bowman was born in Mississippi on December 29, 1937. Her grandfather had been born a slave, but her father was a physician and her mother a teacher. Though they were Methodists, they enrolled her in a Catholic school at age 9, and she asked them if she could become Catholic. After high school, she joined the Franciscan Sisters of Perpetual Adoration in La Crosse, Wisconsin, the only Black sister in the congregation. She went on to higher studies at the Catholic University in Washington, D.C., earning a PhD in English. After teaching for 16 years, she became directly involved in ministry to her fellow African Americans. Gifted with a brilliant mind, a beautiful voice, and a dynamic personality, Sister Thea shared the message of God's love through inspirational talks across the country. Her work had a huge impact upon Catholic liturgical music in providing an intellectual, spiritual, historical, and cultural foundation for developing and legitimizing a distinct worship for the Black Catholic Church. In 1984, Sister Thea was diagnosed with breast cancer. She prayed, "To live until I die. I want to live until I die," she said. Her prayer was answered, and Thea continued her gatherings, seated in a wheelchair. In 1989, the U.S. bishops invited her to be a key speaker at their conference on Black Catholics. She died at age 52 on March 30th, 1990. O God, you raised up your daughter Thea to show us the beauty and the joy of worship that is grounded in life experience. Teach us to pray from our hearts in ways that spill over into justice. Richard Rohr brings to life these three African Americans. Sojourner Truth, 1797 through 1883, was born a slave. Her mother taught her children strategies for survival by sitting under the stars and calling upon God. Her contemplation of the book of nature expanded her understanding of the biblical story of creation. If God is in all, and is all, God cannot tire and rest, for the waters would not flow, and the fishes could not swim, and all motion would have to cease. Her inner strength, her inner life, made her a fearless speaker of convincing insights. Rebecca Cox Jackson was born into a free family. One night, shuddering with fear, during a lightning storm, she was overcome with feelings of peace and protection and a desire to share the love of God had poured into her. She became an itinerant preacher and founded the first Black Shaker community. Jerina Lee was born of free Black parents, but was hired out to work for other families far from home. In a quiet moment, she heard a voice telling her to go preach the gospel. She was told by her church that only men could preach, and she asked why. Seeing that our Savior died for the women as well as the men, if to preach the gospel by the gift of heaven comes by inspiration solely, is God straightened? She became the first authorized woman preacher and the African Methodist Episcopal Church. Jesus asked, "Which of these do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" He replied, "The one who showed him mercy." Jesus said, "Go and do likewise." May we all be open to the call of God in our lives, whoever and whatever you know God to be. And let's hope against hope that what we thought to be impossible may be possible through faith that grows with grace and glory to God. Can I get an amen? Amen. Spirit of abundance, God of grace, Mother of hope, we pause now to remember those stories that are all around us, but so often passed over. Those stories that, when told, are shared because of what someone is, not who they are. This month in our nation's calendar, Black History Month, help us to realize that Black history is all of our histories. May the day come when these stories are so widely taught that no month need be separately divided. We know this day will not come until we as a people make different choices. We pray now for those new choices. May we come to see a day where the prison system becomes redemptive, not punitive. A day where the legal system learns to focus more squarely on the facts and not the colors of our skin. A day where our schools are as well-funded as the needs demand. May our role models be allowed to excel when they thrive and not be taken down for their rich heritage. We know this will require a shift in power, and this can be scary for some. Give those full of fear hope. May we come to know grace so that our hearts will not be hardened to the pain around us. There are so many beautiful stories needing to be told, and we need to get the chance to hear them. Widen our vision so that the history that is shared this month and every month can come to be known as our history too. We are most human when we see the humanity in others. God, hear our prayer. Amen. Please join me in the benediction. The benediction today comes from the Africana Worship Book, Year B, Volume 2. Brothers and sisters, your dreams should not go unnoticed. God knows your dreams. Now dare to dream out loud, so the world may discover what you and God can do. Release every God-given dream so that others may be inspired to do likewise, To the author of every good and noble dream, we give all honor and praise. And may the God in you, the divine image to which you are made, see the God in me and all of the wonderful saints that will cross our paths in the days that lie ahead. Peace. Amen.